Massey Show. And here's your host, Chris Massey.
Hi, I'm Rachel Jordan, and welcome to the Chris Massey Show here on American Hearts Radio Network. We're coming to you live from our studio right here in downtown Atlanta. Now, you're probably asking yourself, where is Chris Massey? Well, if you happen to know, would you please call the studio? I'd like to say I'm surprised, but this is just typical. It's the most important show of the whole year, and he's nowhere to be found. You think it's all fun and games working with Chris Massey? Is it any fun, Al?
No.
He's the most self-centered, self-absorbed ass I've ever met in my whole life. Listen to what he told me one time, and I quote, "I may not be much, but I'm all I think about." Oh, well, look who's here. Where the hell have you been?
It's a long story. Look, I'm sorry I'm late.
You hear that, everyone? He's sorry. I certainly feel better. Do you feel any better, Al?
No.
Look, just, I gotta get my act together here. Just finish the monologue, alright?
Unbelievable.
Go ahead.
Tonight we are taking a look back at the legendary Atlanta Music Club, the 688. Our guest tonight will be Steve May. So grab a beer and relax, it'll be a good one tonight. We'll be right back.
The hardest thing about mastering the English language is learning our proper use of slang. Years ago, I had a crew working down on Tuxedo Drive in Buckhead, you know, the richest neighborhood in Atlanta. And anyway, it was a hot day, and I had a guy working down there who was from Argentina. He'd only been in the country a couple of weeks. It was a hot day, so the lady brought out a tall pitcher of lemonade for him to drink. He took a sip of it and said, "Oh, man." She goes, "You like that, don't you?" And he said, "Oh, yeah, this is good shit." Now, the word shit has been around for a long time. Many historians trace it back all the way to the 14th century, and many of them believe it originated on the cargo ships. Back in those days, they used to ship manure, and when the manure would get wet, it would release a toxic gas. So the crew didn't have to smell the gas, they would place the manure high up on the ship. So when it arrived on the dock, it was labeled Ship High in Transit, or SHIT. I bet you didn't know that, Al, did you?
Nope, got me with that one.
I got you with that one. Other people say, well, it just showed up in the 1500s in England, and the word simply means to defecate. Wherever the word came from, for over 400 years, shit meant shit. But in the late 1960s, with the counterculture, shit began to take on a whole new meaning. Now today, it's synonymous with almost everything we say. I mean, there's good shit, bad shit, tight shit, loose shit, rough shit, tough shit. There's the animal variety, chicken shit, horse shit, bullshit, and my personal favorite, happy horse shit, whatever the hell that is. You can stand in shit, step in shit, sit in shit, be shit on, be shit at, be a shithead, be a shit ass, be shit out of luck, or just be plain shitty. You can want the shit, I need the shit, who's got the shit, where can I get the shit? You cannot want the shit, I don't need the shit, I can't use the shit, quit doing that shit, I'm not doing the shit, and quit talking shit. There's a piece of shit, pile of shit, mountain of shit, shit load, not enough shit, too much shit. You get too much shit, you're going to get tired of the shit. You get tired of the shit, and then you're going to get sick of the shit. You can know your shit, not know your shit, forget your shit, remember your shit, and who the hell is Jack Shit? Everybody talks about this guy, but nobody seems to know who the hell he is. You can stash your shit, you can pack up and move your shit. When you're moving your shit, someone can steal your shit. You can get your shit back and get the shit to where it's going. Once you get the shit there, well, then you can lose your shit. If you lose your shit, you got to find your shit. And once you found your shit, you can get your shit together. How about that shit?
Yeah, man.
And I guess the owner of the Corkscrew Cafe is here tonight. Comedian Mia Jackson is here. We also have a new episode of the Hippy Dippy Classic Album Review with Rachel Jordan. So hell, it's time to watch Chris Massey Show. Get your beer and relax. We'll be right back.
Yes, that's what it will say.
All right. Now, that night I saw you there, you were very funny. You were very funny. You came out. And I hope you don't mind me saying this, but the first thing you told the audience was you said your titties are sweating and
what?
You need to get some titty deodorant. That's what you said.
I don't remember that. That sounds like something I would say.
Well,
I said
if you, okay, if I you did. Didn't say it, you can
I
use it
did,
in your bed.
I did say it. I said it. I will own that, people. I said it.
That's right. That's right. And then I remember you said that one of your girlfriends told you you should use some cornstarch, but you told her, I don't cook, bitch. You remember?
Cook? Where am I? I don't even know what cornstarch is. What is that?
See, I was paying attention.
You know what I said?
I was paying attention.
Yes.
It was very good.
It's Leon Smoker with Rachel Jordan.
Networks make me go to this Kiss concert with you.
Well, you know, man, sometimes I get lost. You know, I have a hard time getting found.
Where'd you even find this car?
You know that dude that does the Batman show at 11 a.m. on Saturdays?
Oh, yeah, so he let you borrow it?
Well, sort of.
What do you mean, sort of?
Well, I mean, my car broke down and I kind of sort of took his.
Well, did you ask him for permission?
No.
So you stole it?
Well, man, look, it's not really stealing, man. We're going to give it back to him after we get back from the concert.
It's unbelievable.
Now, look, man, when we get to the concert, I've got some weed in the glove box there, man, and I want you to put it in your purse and take it into the concert for me.
Have you lost your mind?
Oh, shit.
What?
Oh, man, it's the cops, man. Quick, get that weed out, man, and shove it down your pants.
I'm not shoving weed down my pants.
Oh, shit, here he comes. Play cool, play cool.
Hello, sir.
Hello, officer. Listen, man, if you pull us over because you think we've got marijuana in this car, we don't have any in here.
You were speeding.
Yeah.
Are you Leon Smoker?
Yeah. Yeah, man, I'm Leon Smoker. Yeah, that's right, man. And this is Rachel Jordan.
I've seen both your shows.
Hi, officer.
Man, you need to do a Black Sabbath review.
So you'd like to see us do a, a review of a Black Sabbath record, huh?
You can go slow it down.
Okay. All right, man. Well, listen, man, I really appreciate it. Man, that was close.
You're an idiot.
Officers require assistance.
I just want to celebrate another day of living. I just want to celebrate another day of life.
All right, we're back. This next segment of the show is brought to you by SafeSap Environmental Condoms. SafeSap Environmental Condoms, made with only the natural ingredients in the forest. Just don't get back to nature. Get down with nature with SafeSap Environmental Condoms. SafeSap Environmental Condoms, makers of the pine-scented condom for the sequoia in your life. SafeSap Environmental Condoms. Mr. Joe Hall.
Thank you. That crowded bar before a tailgate underneath the stars. Now it's just you and me and a bottle of wine. And got the radio playing nothing but time. I built a fire by the riverside so we can slow dance till the morning light. We fall in love a little bit more like we have a thousand times before. Compares to a moment like this, and we kiss, we kiss. The look in your eyes and the touch of your lips, girl, I hold you close with such tenderness, and we kiss. I lose my mind every time.
Our eyes and we kiss, we kiss.
comes on and we sing along. Nothing compares to the moment like this and we. Such tenderness and weak years. I lose my mind every time we kiss.
Hey, man, are we on TV?
Yes, Leon, we're on TV.
Okay, I'm cool.
Tonight we are reviewing the 1987 Geffen record release of Appetite for Destruction by LA rock band Guns N' Roses. The album entered the Billboard Top 200 at number 182, eventually making it all the way to number 1, where it stayed for 4 weeks.
Right on.
As of 2008, the album has sold 18 million copies. The Boston debut album, Boston, which came out in 1976, has long been regarded as the best debut album in rock history. But today, many rock critics agree that the top spot belongs to Guns N' Roses. Leon, what is your take on Appetite for Destruction?
Well, this album can really be reviewed in just two words. It rocks. Well, do you want me to talk some more?
Well, yeah. Don't you want to talk about the musicians, maybe some of the tracks?
Oh, okay. This album features electrifying guitar work from Slash. He's the one wearing the hat. A tight rhythm section from bassist Duff McKagan and drummer Steven Adler. Fine rhythm guitar work from Izzy Stradling. And haunting and screeching vocals from a then not so screwed up Axl Rose. My favorite tracks on the record are Hold Up, Ramble On, The Lemon Song, Heartbreaker, and Livin' Lovin' Made.
Are you serious?
What do you mean?
Those are tracks from Led Zeppelin 2.
They are?
Yes.
Are you sure?
Yes, I'm sure.
Oh, man, you know what must have happened was I had the Led Zeppelin 2 CD in the Appetite for Destruction CD case when I was listening to the CD.
And you couldn't tell the difference?
Well, I mean, you know, I was getting high and just kind of listening to it, and I guess I just got kind of lost in it.
You got lost in it.
Yeah, that's right.
Look, Leon, you promised Mike Aloia, the CEO of American Hearts, that you wouldn't be smoking weed when you were reviewing the records or before you came on the show. Leon, have you been smoking weed today?
Well, yeah, a little bit. Look, man, I thought what he said was I couldn't smoke weed on the show.
No, he didn't say you couldn't smoke weed on the show.
He didn't?
No.
So you're saying I can't smoke weed on the show?
No! Just shut up! Just shut up! Now you listen to me, Leon Smoker. You are not going to drag me down. I come on the show, I'm prepared, and I'm professional, and you can't even listen to the right record.
Hey, man, I don't think I want to work with you. You're kind of hostile.
Hostile? You've ruined the whole show.
Nah, just hold your horses there, Pocahontas. Let's don't go crazy quite yet. I mean, don't you think somewhere down the line we're going to review Led Zeppelin 2?
Probably.
Look, man, I've already listened to it. That puts me a couple steps ahead of the game.
You are not a couple steps ahead of the game. We were supposed to review Appetite for Destruction. What part of that do you not understand?
So you're saying I screwed up? Well, look, I didn't do it on purpose, man.
Just take us out.
Join us next time on the Hippy Dippy Classic Album Review when we will be looking at the Iron Butterfly Classic in a Gotta Da Vida, and the major impact it had on the disco movement of the late 1970s. Until then, I'm Leon Smoker.
And I'm Rachel Jordan.
See you next time. Hi, everybody. I'm Rick Renfro. Say you're having a little trouble getting going in the morning. By the afternoon time, you feel like you need a nap. That morning and afternoon cup of coffee just isn't doing it anymore for you. Well, it's time you try Coffee Crank. That's right, Coffee Crank. We take the finest coffee beans from Colombia and mix it with methamphetamine made in someone's basement right here in the good old U.S. of A. Coffee Crank goes down smooth. It's very effective. Hey, man, it's like rocket fuel. But don't take my word for it. Listen to Betty Johnson, a Coffee Crank drinker.
Hi, I'm Betty Johnson. Before I started drinking Coffee Crank, I was the worst employee at work. I was out of shape and so tired when I got home, I never wanted to have sex with my husband. He wanted a divorce. But now, after only drinking Coffee Creek for 1 week, I'm the most productive worker in the history of the company. Going to the gym every day is a snap, and every night I come home and bang my husband till he passes out. Coffee Crank has changed my life.
Wow, Betty, that's really impressive. How about some Coffee Crank right now?
Don't mind if I do. You can feel it working instantly.
Now what about those times you say when you want a great tasting cup of coffee but you don't want to get wound up? then you need to try Coffee Crank Decaf. We take away the caffeine and the amphetamine and mix in high-grade quality heroin. Just one cup of Coffee Crank Decaf and you're going to be feeling melangella and too smooth to move. But what about those times when you don't know which way you want to go? Try this. Pour yourself a half a cup of Coffee Crank and mix in a half a cup of Coffee Crank Decaf. What have you got? It's the Coffee Crank Speedball. That's right. It'll get you going till you find out where it is that you need to be. Coffee Crank, available at your local grocery store. Get some today and crank it up with Coffee Crank. But the most interesting, really interesting part of this law is that it specifically says that you can now bring your gun to church. Well, I have to tell you, if you feel so unsafe in your place of worship that you feel like you need to pack a piece on Sunday morning, you might want to find a new church. I mean, hell, I know all about it. I was raised in a Southern Baptist church. Hellfire and brimstone. Every Sunday somebody was telling me I was going to hell when all I really wanted to do was just go home and watch the NFL on CBS with Brent Musburger. But before I could go, we had to stand up and sing 112 stanzas of Just As I Am till some poor sap walked down the aisle and joined the church. Now, if guns would have been allowed in my church in the 1970s, there'd have been a shot fired every Sunday. Because after about 12 stanzas of Just As I Am, somebody would have been blowing their brains out. I mean, hell, I was only 10 years old. Give me a gun. I'll shoot somebody if it means we can go home. Isn't it enough that we get up early, put on clothes we don't want to wear, come down here, put money in the offering plate we ain't got, sit here for an hour while you tell us we're going somewhere we don't want to go, and then to make it all better, we have to stand up and sing the worst song ever written until you sell another Jesus membership. Now let me tell you, in my music career, I've had to sing a lot of songs I didn't want to sing. Sweet Home Alabama, Free Bird, The Coal Miner's Daughter. Okay, I've never sang The Coal Miner's Daughter, but if I had to, it would be on this list. Mustang Sally, Louie Louie. But if you want me to sing Just As I Am, you better bring a gun and be prepared to use it. We got a great show for you tonight. Wax and Facts owner Danny Beard is here. Country singer Karen Womack. Guitarist Chris Blackwell. We have Muhammad Azhar and Rachel Jordan here as well. So get you a beer and relax. We're going to have a good time here tonight. We'll be right back. Hey everybody, I'm Chris Massey and welcome to the Chris Massey Show here on the American Hearts Radio Network. We're coming to you live tonight from our studio here in downtown Atlanta. Well folks, there's only 10 shopping days left till Christmas, and you know what that means. Everybody out there is going out of their mind. That's what it means. Did you know that in the United States of America during the Christmas shopping season, every day somebody goes to jail over an altercation in a parking lot over a parking space? Did you know that, Al? That's kind of hard to believe, isn't it?
Yeah, man.
You know? And right now as we speak, there are millions of people out there buying Christmas gifts with their credit cards, which means they're buying gifts with money they don't have. Lots of times they're giving these gifts to people they don't even like, and lots of times they're giving them stuff that they don't even need. I tell you what, Christmas has gotten all out of whack. And it's also the time of year when the religious right gets on their soapbox. See, they have a problem with people spelling Xmas. You know, don't have enough space in the window, so you write X-M-A-S. They say that's blasphemy, leaving Christ out of the word Christmas. Well, even though Michelle Bachmann says that the Bible was written in English, it really wasn't. It was written in Greek. And the Greek word for Christ is spelled X-P-I-O-T-I-O. And for a long time, people have been using the word X for Christ. So there's no reason for you to get upset. It's not the work of an atheist group, an agnostic group, the Jewish people, the Muslims, the Hindus. It's basically just you being a moron. Now, in Chicago, Illinois, James and Mary Johnson and their little boy Jake. Jake's only 5 years old, and they decided that they weren't going to play the Christmas card with Jake, and they decided they were going to tell him the truth, you know, that they're heading to Santa Claus. This was a bad move. Jake went to school the next day and told everybody in class that there wasn't no Santa Claus and that his mom and dad said that there wasn't. Well, you can imagine what happened. That afternoon, she got about 12 calls from the school, you know, raising Cain, and parents having a fit. You've never seen so many adults scrambling to cover up a lie in your entire life. Now, Christmas shouldn't be that complicated, you know? I mean, we're supposed to be celebrating the birth of Christ. I mean, how complicated could that be? But the story even gets complicated. According to the story, Mary, Jesus' mother, is having a baby. There's only one little catch of that. She's never had sex before. And then you've got this whole thing with Santa Claus. You know, some guy lives at the North Pole. He's got reindeer that fly him around in a sled. And somehow, in 24 hours, he flies all around the globe and is able to squeeze his fat ass down the chimney and give gifts to the good boys and girls everywhere. And he intuitively knows which homes are Jewish, Jehovah's Witness, Muslim, and Hindu, and he doesn't go there. Let me tell you something. Kids these days aren't dummies, and it ain't going to be long. About 50 years from now, somebody's going to be telling their kid about Santa Claus, and they're going to look at him and say, bullshit. What are you buying me, Mommy? What are you getting me for Christmas? So me and my wife, we have a nice, quiet Christmas. Our kids are grown. They got everything that they need. We show up at a couple of family dinners, then we sit in our living room and stare at our soon-to-be-dead tree that we put in our living room with electric lights on it. But there's one thing that I do really enjoy during Christmas, and that's this. When somebody tells me Merry Christmas, I always say Happy Holidays, just to piss them off!
Thinking of you, loving him, wondering what could have been. He still have a picture of me, both keep thinking, was it meant to be? The timing was all, but just wasn't right, just didn't think.
Guest tonight, well, he really needs no introduction. I mean, he's been part of the Atlanta music scene going all the way back to 1967. He's appeared in movies. He's cut several CDs. He's played with the likes of Chuck Berry, Tom Waits, once appeared on the James Brown Show. Everybody in Atlanta that's ever picked up a guitar, played drums, sings, or been to a comedy club knows who he is, and we're honored to have him here tonight. Would you please welcome the one and only Mr. Dale Rhodes?
Thank you, thank you, thank you. Hey, I love this band. Hey, all right. Yeah.
All right, Daryl. Good to see you, man.
And, nice to be here.
And thanks for being on the show. I really appreciate it.
I heard some of your monologue, and I just want to say I'm so glad that David Perdue won because, you know, Michelle Nunn, you know, bringing in ISIS and Ebola and, you know, being responsible for all that stuff. You know, she was the one, I think, that sort of illegally brought in some ISIS people with Ebola. So,
well, that would explain why she lost, I guess, you know. So, anyway. All right, Daryl. Oh, and that check for $5,000 that American Hearts cut to your manager, it will be there tomorrow, but they're going to have to hold it the next Friday. But I promise you.
Dude, that's exciting, dude!
I can't tell you how much I appreciate the work you do here on the show. I look forward to working with you again next year.
Dude, you are a genius, man. I just never know what's going to come out of your mouth every week, so I just can't wait for you.
There, I told you I'd do that. Okay. All right, everybody, Al Burrows, we'll be right back.
He does pay.
Hi, I'm Rachel Jordan, and welcome to the Hippy Dippy Classic Album Review. I'm joined by acclaimed rock critic, Leon Smoker. Leon, how are you doing tonight?
Yeah, I'm doing good. I'm doing good.
All right, good. Tonight, we're reviewing the 1975 epic record release, Ted Nugent. This was Ted's first solo album after leaving the Amboy Dukes. The album made it all the way to number 30 on the Billboard charts, and the single, Hey Baby, made it to number 72 on the Billboard Top 100. The album's first track, Stranglehold, put Ted on the map as a serious contender for rock's top spot in the 1970s. The album would eventually sell 2 million copies and make Ted a must-see touring act during the era. Leon, what is your take on the Ted Nugent album?
Well, I was over at Stacy Ferguson's house, and she was having a party, and we were upstairs, and about five or six of us, and we were smoking some weed, you know.
Wait a minute. How old were you in 1976?
I was 14.
And you were already smoking weed?
Yeah.
So how old are you now?
I'm 52.
Leon, that means you've been smoking weed for 38 years.
Hey, wow, man, that's a long time. Can I do the review now?
Go ahead.
All right. So we were up there, and Rick Manton puts on the Ted Nugent album, and Stranglehold comes on. Man, that was the first time I'd ever heard a hollow body Gibson coming through a Fender amp. It was the first spiritual experience of my life.
Could you explain what that means, please?
What I mean, man, is that God came in the room.
God came into the room.
That's right. He was there. I can't remember if he hit the doobie or not, but he was there.
You're a real piece of work. You know that?
Unfortunately for Ted, that was the highlight of his career. He later went on to do a double platinum album, Free For All, and a triple platinum album called Cat Scratch Fever. After that, he started making some bad decisions. First thing he did was he fired his talented rhythm guitar and lead singer, Derek St. Holmes. Then bassist Rod Grange left the band shortly after that. Then he put out a series of bad records, man. I mean, he had this single in 1979 called The Wango Tango. This is one of the worst songs ever played on commercial radio. I mean, man, it's right up there with the Captain Antonio's Muskrat Love and Paul Anka, You're Having My Baby. Then after that, in the 80s, he joined this band called the Damn Yankees. They had former members of Styx and Night Ranger. Well, that alone ought to tell you how bad that band sucked. So today, unfortunately, Ted is more political than he is musical. And that's a shame. Come on, Ted. Who's going to take you serious about politics, man, when your biggest hit was a song about catching a venereal disease? So you got to make up your mind, man. Do you want to be on Fox News talking about stuff you know nothing about? Or you want to be in the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame, where people appreciate your song about venereal disease?
I can't believe they've been making me do this show with someone who's been smoking weed for 38 years.
Well, it could be a hell of a lot worse.
How's that?
You could be doing this show with Ted Nugent.
You know, that's a good point, Leon. Why don't you take us out?
All right. Join us next time on the Hippy Dippy Classic Album Review, when we will be looking at the possibility that if Paul McCartney dies before Ringo Starr, that Ringo's going to put together a band and tour as the Beatles. Until next time, I'm Leon Smoker.
And I'm Rachel Jordan.
See you next time.
I'm Rick Richards at Georgia Satellites, and you're watching The Chris Massey Show live.
Hi, I'm Rachel Jordan, and welcome to How Is That Possible? I'm joined by Professor Muhammad Azhar. Muhammad, how are you doing tonight?
I am excellent.
All right, so Muhammad, you've been calling the station constantly for the last month, so what is it so important that you have to tell everybody?
I want to know why they take me off the show. Every time I turn on the Chris Massey Show, it's you and the hippie man. They never ask me to come back again.
You mean Leon Smoker?
Yes, the guy with the girly hair.
Well, you know, Muhammad, the network just doesn't think you're very funny.
Nobody told me I was supposed to be funny. They told me I was here to talk about serious matter, and that is what I talk about.
So what do you want to talk about?
Well, tonight I want to talk about why is it we live in a world where you can do almost anything, but yet the freaking cell phone company cannot make a screen that does not shatter on your telephone. The cell phone companies are making millions of dollars on broken screens every day.
So what are we supposed to do about it?
Well, unfortunately, there's not much you can do. We are all trapped in the tight grip of cell phone dependency. And until we can quit using cell phones, we're going to continue to take it up the poop chute from the cell phone companies.
Did you just say poop chute?
Yes. Do you need me to translate?
Well, you could put it in a nicer way.
How about this? Up your ass!
This is why they don't want you on the network anymore.
Why, because I'm not funny?
Because you're an idiot! Just say goodbye, Muhammad.
Goodbye. Hey, everybody, I'm Chris Massey, and welcome to the Chris Massey Show here on the American Hearts Radio Network. We're coming to you live tonight from our studio here in downtown Atlanta. Now, on last week's show, I made some comments about the new Senate House Majority Leader, Mitch McConnell, and man, did it cause quite an uproar. We've received hundreds of emails and phone calls from people that are pissed off because I said that Mitch McConnell was an idiot and he didn't like Barack Obama because he was black, which I guess means that I called him a racist. So let's just read one of the letters that came in. This is from Jan in Jackson, Mississippi. Jan writes in, Chris, you are nothing more but a bleeding heart liberal with a microphone shooting your mouth off about things you don't know anything about. If you'd have done your research, you'd have found out that Mitch McConnell has an Asian wife. So how can he be racist? Come on, Jan, don't be so naive. Even the boys in the Ku Klux Klan like an egg roll every now and then. Well, that don't mean they're going to go vacationing in Hong Kong. Now, Jan, I know you're tight. You're the kind out there that's making global warming jokes on the day it was cold in the wintertime. You're quick to point out that gas was $1.86 a gallon when George Bush left office, but failed to mention that the stock market was at 6,000 points. And you like to walk around and tell people, oh, George Bush, he sure did keep us safe. Well, all except for that one day when 5,000 people got killed. That's kind of like a wife saying, yeah, my husband, he's been faithful, all except for that one night I came home and caught him banging the babysitter. Now, my guess is, Jan, you are a middle-class working Republican, and if you are, well, that makes you a bigger idiot than Mitch McConnell. I mean, I guess that you didn't get the memo like the rest of you middle-class people that the GOP's whole agenda is to make the richest Americans in America richer at the price of the middle class and the working class. But I'll say one thing. The Republicans have done a great job of brainwashing you guys. To hear you people talk, you have absolutely no problem with the CEO of a big company making $40 million. But by God, we can't have anybody at Walmart making $10 an hour. So if I pissed you off, Jan, and all those other people, there's a real good reason for that. I was trying to. All right, we have got a great show tonight. The one and only Daryl Rhodes is here with me for the whole evening. So get a beer, sit back, and relax. It's going to be a good one tonight. We'll be right back.
So we were doing sitting up in David's loft to try to look for a logo that we could use our merchandise. And we tried Sweeney Todd's, and we could just not. That just didn't look good. And so I saw the album P.I.L. in the corner, which has that little, the two bars in the circle with P.I.L.
Right.
And,
mm-hmm.
And then David came up with 688 Spring Street, 688. And then we put that. Just sort of reversed the PIL logo, and it, well, there it is. Everybody
there it
can
is,
see.
Right there.
And there's,
there it is.
And that's how 688 became.
Now, another location, that, and this I've got to tell you, this is really kind of funny. another location you guys were looking to open the club, and you said you almost signed a lease there.
Real close.
Was where the Third Rock,
$3 cafe.
$3 cafe, right in the middle of Buckhead.
Right in the middle of Buckhead.
Now, I can just picture, Steve, all of these punks coming down to see these shows, and Buckhead was full of these then. I mean, the only place they weren't was at Hedgens down there where the Satellites were playing, and they would have been coming into the show and to check it out. I think you would have had the cops there an awful lot if the club would have been
I'm going to tell you, 680 on the weekends, especially in from 83 on, became like a yuppie hangout on weekends.
Right.
So I'm not taking that away from anything. And, you know, there were some people that I liked that were yuppies. I mean, I grew up in that sort of lifestyle. But anyway, $3 Cafe was a place that we looked at the beginning because it was vacant and it was for rent. But the cost to renovate that place and bring in bar equipment was so expensive. Like, a lot of people don't realize, but I had saved up, and I had about $10,000 saved up, and Tony had borrowed $10,000 from his parents. So our nest egg to open up 688 was $20,000. I mean, today that's unheard of to open up any club or anything.
Oh, yeah.
But we got it up and going, and we kept it going for almost 7 years.
That's right. So. Yeah, and I tell you, where you had the place, I mean, that was fate. The fact that it was as small as it was big and it was small all at kind of the same time, really made it a great place.
Yeah, Rose had just let her lease go.
At Rose's Cantina.
Rose's Cantina, that's what 688 was before. And so it became vacant, and I just said, Tony, look, we don't even have to do much, you know.
That's right.
So let's just take it over, and that's how 688 began.
Hey, everybody, I'm Chris Massey, and welcome to the Chris Massey Show here on the American Hearts Radio Network. We're coming to you live tonight from our studio here in downtown Atlanta. Well, you've never seen me in this attire on the show, and I'm going to tell you why. Someone stole my cowboy hat, stole my jacket, stole all my notes out of my car. I'm completely unprepared tonight, so I don't know what this is going to be like. You know, what can I tell you? When you're a big web TV celebrity like me, everybody wants to get some of your stuff, and my stuff's gone. Can you believe that, Al? Somebody would steal my cowboy hat.
That's jacked up, man.
It is, man. I mean, I just don't even feel right in this stocking cap. I just, you know, but if you saw what was underneath it, you'd know why I've got it on. Anyway, so let's see what we can talk about tonight. Well, in a couple of weeks, we have the midterm elections, and it looks like the Republicans have got a strong hold on the House and have a good chance to get the Senate. And that makes a lot of people happy, especially down here in the South, because as we all know, the Republicans can get in there and get this mess straightened out, just like they did when George Bush was president. Now, recently I saw Bill O'Reilly on TV, and he was saying that things haven't gotten any better since Barack Obama's been president. Now, I don't know where Bill was in 2008, but he must have been where a lot of Republicans were, because they seem to have forgotten what was going on back then. So I'm going to give you a little refresher course, all right? The last 6 months of 2008, we lost 3 million jobs. That's 500,000 jobs a month. The stock market plummeted 9,000 points. 9,000 points. And for the first time in American history, people's home values plummeted. And after 8 years of giving the richest 1% in this country huge tax breaks so they could create jobs for the rest of us, unemployment was at 10%. Well, today the stock market is up over 15,000 points. Unemployment is at 5.9%. We're not losing jobs. We're gaining jobs every month. People's home values are going up. And millions of people who had pre-existing conditions that couldn't get insurance back in 2008 now have insurance because of Obamacare. And you're looking at one of them. So you wonder, why is it Bill can come on TV and say something like that? Well, he's just following the Fox News template, which is this. We don't have to tell the truth because we're really not a news channel. Now, what's been bothering me all this time is how much people hate Barack Obama. I mean, it's unbelievable. I mean, I know you can dislike a president and you don't like his policies and everything, but man, this guy is hated. I mean, especially down here in the South. Did you know that Barack Obama has had 3 times as many death threats as any president we've ever had? Now, let me break that down for you. That means he's had more death threats than George W. Bush, Bill Clinton and George Bush Sr. combined. Now, what is it that's different about Barack Obama than these other three presidents? Or all the other presidents we've had? Well, if you can't figure that out, you gotta be blind. That's all I can tell you. Now, in a recent poll among Southern Republicans, 22% of these people say that Barack Obama could be, or may well very be, the Antichrist. Come on, man, where do you find these people at? For crying out loud. Let me assure you, Barack Obama is not the Antichrist. He's just black.
I'm Rachel Jordan, and welcome to the Hippie Dippy Classic Album Review. I'm joined by acclaimed rock critic Leon Smoker. Leon, how are you doing tonight?
Man, I'm good. I'm okay. And I'm ready.
Okay, then. Tonight we are reviewing the 1976 epic record release Boston by the rock group Boston. This was the band's debut album and at the time was considered the greatest debut album in rock history. The album has sold over 20 million copies. The album peaked at number 3 on the Billboard charts and remained there for 132 weeks. The single, More Than a Feeling, made it all the way to number 5. Leon, what is your take on the Boston album?
Well, this album came out in the summer of 1976, right before my freshman year of high school. And on the single, More Than a Feeling, it's got this lyric that says, I see my Marianne walking away. Well, at the time, I had this crush on this girl named Marianne. She didn't want anything to do with me. So for that reason, I've never liked this song, never liked this band, never liked this album. So I'm going to say this album stinks.
What do you mean the album stinks? You can't base the whole review on the fact that some 14-year-old girl named Marianne didn't want anything to do with you.
Well, why can't I?
Because, Leon, you're supposed to be professional. This album is a rock and roll classic and is an insult to all music fans for you to come on this show and say the album stinks. Now do the review like you're supposed to.
All right. God. What did I tell you about being hostile? Yeah. All right then. This album features the guitar wizardry of Tom Scholz. Outside of Davy Johnstone, lead guitar player for Elton John, he's probably the tallest guitar player in rock history. Now, The single More Than a Feeling, no, excuse me, More Than a Feeling, oh wait, or is it A Good Feeling? No, it's More Than a Feeling, which is better when you're talking about feelings because everybody likes more, right? Anyway, every track on this album received airplay. I mean every track. Long Time, Peace of Mind, Rock and Roll Band, Something About You, Smoking, Hitching a Ride, and Let Me Take You Home Tonight. But what made the album really rock was the vocals of singer Brad Delp. Brad Delp is the best and most underrated singer of the late 1970s. At the time now, Boston is on tour. But unfortunately, Mr. Delp is unable to perform because in 2007, he killed himself. See, I mean, look, man, everything about this record is a bummer, man. I mean, look, the singer killed himself. Marianne Heath wouldn't be my girlfriend. And, I mean, there's nothing good about this record. Just nothing good at all.
Well, it sold 20 million copies. There's got to be something to it.
What, you're saying because people bought it, it's good?
Yeah, that's what I'm saying.
Well, I disagree. You see this?
What does a can of Spam have to do with the Boston album?
Well, I'll tell you. This is on every shelf in every grocery store in America, and it has been for decades. So, I mean, a lot of people buy this stuff. Rachel, do you eat Spam?
No.
How come?
Because it's gross.
There. I rest my case. So if you want a review from Leon Smoker, here it is. Don't eat Spam, and don't listen to Boston.
Leon, I think I liked you better when you were smoking weed.
What? You thought I wasn't smoking weed tonight?
Unbelievable. Take us out.
Join us next time on the Hippy Dippy Classic Album Review, where we will be discussing the reasons why no one in America has started a Loverboy tribute band. Until then, my name is Leon Smoker.
And I'm Rachel Jordan.
See you next time.
Fall in love when all this heartache wasn't in love. the plan. Heartache. I can't stand to feel the pain. The seeds I sow, chilled to the bone. Don't want to live my life with all this heartache. Alone again. Lonely. Where can I go? So lonely. I don't know, 'cause I'm so run from myself, so lonely. Can't find the help to ease the pain of all my years. I cry the tears, don't want to live my life with all this heartache.
Today is Veterans Day, and I'd like to send out a special thank you to everybody that served in the military and all you people out there that are serving right now as I'm speaking. We really appreciate all you do to keep this country safe. Now, the past week I've had to go get some shoulder surgery done, and I put it off for a couple of months because, well, actually a couple of years. And the reason I put it off was because I didn't have any insurance. Nobody would give me insurance because I had a pre-existing condition. Well, now because of the Affordable Health Care Act, or Obamacare, whichever you want to call it, I have insurance, and I was able to go get the surgery done this week, and my shoulder is mending very nicely, I'm glad to say. Well, I put this out on Facebook that I was getting it done, and you wouldn't believe some of the remarks I got from some of these people out there. People crying like babies because they say their insurance policies are going up $300, $400, $500, $600 a month, even in some instances. And I got to thinking about it. You know what? My insurance went up $700 a month. You know why? Because I didn't have any. And if your insurance is going up $300, $400, $500, $600, you had an inadequate insurance policy to start with, or your employer was paying for it. So guess what, pal? The party's over. Come down from the deck, come down below, get an oar, and start rowing with the rest of us. How about that? Pay for your own health insurance. What a concept. What do you think about that, Al?
Go for it.
I'm telling you, man, it's unbelievable. What these people complain about.
Hey, I'm Leon Smoker.
And I'm Rachel Jordan.
And I'm Moses Moe from Mother's Finest.
And you're watching the Chris Massey Music Show. Hey, man, you remember that time when you guys opened for Aerosmith?
I do. Man, that was awesome.
We're gonna have a drink here, and okay. we're gonna toast the show. Okay, is that okay with you?
That's fine.
Is that
with
okay
me.
With you, Al? Yeah, Al over here, engineering man. He's doing
props for Al. He's been making it look right all night.
Super
tonight.
Job, and I couldn't afford the Jack Daniels, so we're gonna have to go with the Evian. There you all here.
Oh, I appreciate that.
That's no problem. That is no problem.
That's a mighty good pour you got there, my friend.
Well, it's a big drink because it's going to be a big show. I mean, that's all I can tell you. So let's have a little toast here to the Chris Massey Show. Here we go. Bottoms up, my friend.
Oh, good Lord.
Show's over, folks.
Just make sure I get my Rice-A-Roni. Good Lord.
Oh my God. Johnny, you know he's not supposed to be drinking. Chris, wake up. You gotta finish the show.
Where am I?
Web TV!
I'm Rachel Jordan. Welcome to the Hippy Dippy Classic Album Review. I'm joined by acclaimed rock critic Leon Smoker. Leon, how are you doing tonight?
Yeah, I'm doing pretty good.
Alright, good. Tonight we're reviewing the 1980 Columbia record release Loverboy and the Canadian rock band Loverboy. After being rejected by American record companies, Loverboy released their debut album in Canada in March of 1980. The album sold 700,000 copies in Canada. By July, American labels were interested and the album was released. It would sell 2 million copies in the U.S. alone. It had two hits that cracked the Billboard Top 100, The Kid Is Hot Tonight and Turn Me Loose. Today, the band is still out there touring. Now look, Leon, I know you don't like this band.
I never said that.
Yes, you did.
No, I said I hate them and they make me want to puke.
Remember what Michael Aloia said?
I know, favorable and professional reviews.
Okay, so Leon, what is your take on the Loverboy album?
This band sucks.
Damn it, Leon, you've got 5 seconds to do this review like you're supposed to. 5, 4, 3.
Okay, crying out loud. Alright, there are basically two components to this band, singer Mike Reno and guitarist Paul Dean. Now, Paul Dean is not related to Paula Dean, but if you've seen Mike Reno in recent years, you might think that he's been spending a lot of time at Paula Dean's restaurant, if you know what I'm saying. He always wore this stupid headband around his head that made him look like an extra on that Olivia Newton-John video, Let's Getting Physical, you know? But look, Mike Reno is a talented singer. You can't deny that. But let's face it, man, even a chef can't make liver taste good. Listen to some of these lyrics. Everybody's working for the weekend. Everybody wants a new romance. Everybody's going off the deep end. Everybody needs a second chance. You want a piece of my heart? You got to start from the start. Well, where the hell else would you start? At the end? In the middle? I'm here to please, I'm even on my knees, making love to whoever I please, I gotta do it my way. Is anybody buying this crap? Let me tell you, man, even in their prime, if these guys were on their knees, they were either praying, throwing up, or they were begging somebody to make love with them. I mean, who the hell do they think they are, Duran Duran? You know, one night I was in a bar and I saw these two guys get in a fight over who was better, Loverboy or Journey. You know Journey, they're one of those commercial crybaby wet panty bands from San Francisco, corporate rock. Well anyway, the bouncer came over to break it up and he joined in on the conversation. Turns out he was a Motorhead fan, man. He beat the living shit out of both of them. Now last time I was on this show, I said that there was not a Loverboy tribute band in America. Well, I stand to be corrected. There is actually one and it's called Working for the Weekend. On their website, it says they're the greatest Loverboy tribute band in the world, which is true, because they're the only Loverboy tribute band in the world. You know, that's kind of like being the coolest of the uncool, or maybe the third tallest guy in Japan. Well, anyway, that's all I can talk about this band, man. I'm about to spew all over the set right now. So, you mad at me?
No, Leon, I'm not mad at you.
Hmm.
You're right. This band sucks. Take us out.
All right. You finally agree with me. I'm digging that. Join us next time on the Hippy Dippy Classic Album Review when we will be discussing the rumor that Jacksonville High School gym coach Leonard Skinner was actually one time a member of the Allman Brothers. Until then, I'm Leon Smoker.
And I'm Rachel Jordan.
See you next time. So tonight I want to apologize to UDD and Holly Youngblood and Maria Trina and Richard Qualls and Becky Primo and everybody that was at that party. If I ruined it, I'm sorry. But let's face it, the only reason we're talking about your party 38 years later on a web TV show is because I was there and I got drunk. Don't worry, you ain't got to thank me. After tonight, we'll call it even. Get up off your rumpus, turn your TV off, get in front of the computer and check out the hottest new show on web TV, The Chris Massey Show. Now there's a rumor that's been going around that I'm going to have to clear up. And the rumor is that I, Chris Massey, have been asked to make an appearance on the reality show Keeping Up with the Kardashians out in Hollywood. Well, folks, the rumor's true. Seems Kim Kardashian is a big fan of the Chris Massey Band. She's got both my Heartbreak Avenue and Cowboy Heart CDs, and she's also got a Cowboy Heart 2013 concert t-shirt that she's promised me she's going to wear on an upcoming episode of Keeping Up with the Kardashians. Kim, I regret to say, because of my commitments to Massey Gutters and Chris Massey Band and Chris Massey Show and the fact that when I told my wife, she said, oh, hell no, I'm not going to be able to make an appearance on your show. But here's what I can do. On May 29th, the CMB is heading out west for a nine-city tour. And on Tuesday, June the 3rd, we're going to be at the Whiskey-A-Go-Go in Hollywood. Right down the street from your house in Beverly Hills. So I've taken the liberty of putting you on the guest list plus one. And my hope is that you're going to bring with you that conceited, no good, no talent fiance of yours, Kanye West. Because if there's anybody out there claiming to be a bigger creative genius than Jimi Hendrix, I want to meet him. I want to shake his hand, and then I'm going to laugh in his face. Come on, man, you're comparing yourself to the most innovative musician that ever walked on the planet. Why don't you just cut to the chase and compare yourself to Jesus Christ? Better yet, go ahead and compare yourself to God. Then we'll all know without a shadow of a doubt that you're the greatest thing that's ever existed on this planet, and you can quit opening up your mouth and making an ass out of yourself. Now, Kim's sister, Courtney, honey, of course you can get in for free. But let me tell you, that no-good, sorry, gold-digging boyfriend of yours, he's not getting in free. He's paying full price at the door and full price at the bar. I'm going to make sure of it. And Chloe, honey, bless your heart, you're always getting the short end of the stick because Kim and Courtney are so good-looking. But let's face it, you still haven't let anybody take pictures of you naked yet. What are you waiting for? Mama Kardashian, honey, I've always had a little something for you. So you get in free as well. But Bruce Jenner, hey, pal, I don't think we want you down there, man. You're looking a little scary these days. I don't know what's up with that plastic surgery you got, but it ain't working. You might want to go back to your fancy-pantsy Beverly Hills doctor and see if you can get your money back. Better yet, see if you can get your old face back. Just something you might want to think about. Man, I tell you, is there anything more enjoyable than making fun of the rich and famous? Now, anybody can get a date these days. The internet is full of all kinds of dating sites. There's a dating site for Christians, one for farmers. There's even a dating site for Green Bay Packer fans. And there's this dating site called Booty Call, which I don't really think it's a dating site. And there's escort services all up and down the web. So if you're sitting at home not having sex with anybody, well, it's a pretty good chance that you wanted to do it that way. Now, dating is a lot like going on a job interview. The first interview is like this. You ask her some questions, she asks you some questions, and then at the end of the night, you decide if there's going to be a second interview. Now, what constitutes a second interview are two things. One, do you like the person? And number two, could you see yourself getting naked with this person? Now, the second interview, it gets a little more intense. You're going to share some personal information, probably talk about some past relationships. There's probably a hot goodnight kiss in order that night, and then you decide to go on a third interview, which is the first date. Now, about 3-4 dates into this, the man's going to say something like, listen, honey, how about next Saturday night you come over to my house and I'll cook you dinner? Now, this is a very discreet way for the man to say, it's about time for you and I to have sex. So remember, ladies, if you decide to go over there and have that dinner, you're going to get more than a mediocre dinner and a cheap bottle of wine. Now, if you ask a guy if he's in a serious relationship, he automatically goes to the time factor. I don't know. We've been dating a couple of months. I guess you could say it's serious. For a woman, it's completely different. Once the woman has sex with the man, in her mind, it's serious. So remember, guys, once you're in all the way. No pun intended. Now, the sex causes a lot of problems in the relationship. And once you have sex in this relationship, only two things can happen. First one is this. You're going to get married, and in all probability, you'll be divorced in a few years, and you'll hate each other. The other thing is this. Somebody's going to break it off, and somebody's going to get hurt. Now, I don't know anybody that's really good at breaking up with anybody or anybody that likes to get broken up with. So here's some things you need to remember if you're breaking up with somebody. First one is this. This is not the time in your life when you want to be telling the truth. I know the Bible says that we're always supposed to tell the truth, but Jesus never had to break up with anybody. No woman wants to hear that she's too fat or she's not good in bed. And guys don't want to hear that we don't make enough money or our penis is too small. So you need to keep all that information to yourself. Now here's some of the methods that people use when it comes to breaking up. The first one is the drop out of sight method. That's right, just disappear. Don't return any of her phone calls. Don't make any phone calls. And after a while, well, they'll get the message and you'll be home clear. Now, the second one is, yo, it's not you, it's me routine. Well, let's face it. The last time that really worked on somebody was back in the 50s when June Cleaver used it on Ward one night because she didn't feel like giving him head. Now, when you say this to a woman, what you're basically saying is this, I can't tell you the truth because it's going to hurt your feelings. And they're going to haggle you to death until you do tell them. And then, well, you're going to end up upsetting them, and that's what you're trying not to do. Remember, the three things that you want to do and when you're breaking up is this. You want to be respected, you want the person to still like you, and you don't want them to get upset. But, man, I tell you, there's a better chance Ted Nugent's going to sell all of his guns before something like that's going to happen. Another popular method is the, oh, well, I'm not ready for a relationship. Now, this works real good for the women. But, guys, if you're using it and you've already had sex with a woman, you better make sure there's a lot of distance between you and her. You're going to unleash the fury. Take my word for it. So you're saying, Chris, what can we do? Is there anything we can say where the other person is going to respect us, they're still going to like us, and they're not going to get upset? Well, you're in luck. There's one line for the guys and one line for the gals. Now, guys, here's what you do. You get her alone, you look her in the eye, and you say, listen, honey, I've got something to tell you. It's really hard because I really wanted this to go a long way. You look at her and you say, but I'm just not over my ex-wife. This works every single time. When you say this to a woman, you're not telling her that she's not pretty enough or she's not smart enough. I mean, what can she say? You're not over your ex. If she gets too upset, well, then you can use the bonus line is, I can't love with a broken heart. Works every time. Now, for you gals, the mistake you always make is you want to let guys down too easy. We don't respond well to stuff like that. You need to be straight, direct, to the point. And don't leave the door cracked open where we think there's a chance we can get back together. That's just going to cause some harassing phone calls and maybe even some stalking. So you get the guy alone and you look at him and you go, look, I don't know how to say this, so I'm just going to say it. I used to be a man. Whoa! I don't know a heterosexual guy out there that can get over anything like this. Now you're saying he's going to tell all his friends that I used to be a man. No, he's not. He's not going to tell anybody he ever dated you. He's not even going to tell anybody that he ever knew you. Now, guys, unfortunately, this line doesn't work in reverse. I had a buddy of mine that told his girlfriend he used to be a woman. Hell, she thought it was hot. Next thing you know, she wanted to dress him up in women's clothes and take him down to the mall and shop with her. So you really got to be careful. So with all the things we talked about tonight, it's understandable why escort services are such a lucrative business. I know what you're saying. Chris, how can anybody pay for sex? Well, you're looking at it all wrong. You're not paying for sex. You're paying for them to leave. Hey, everybody. I'm Chris Massey, and welcome to the Chris Massey Show here on the American Hearts Radio Network. Welcome to our special Christmas show. This is the last show of season one. This is show number 16, Al. Can you believe that? Wow. 16 shows, and, you know, the network told me they wanted me to wear a Santa hat, and when I got here tonight, they already had it here for me, and, look, this is what they gave me. You know, I think this is supposed to be leopard skin, but it really feels like they shaved a St. Bernard's ass and just kind of glued it on here. Anyway.
Red paint.
That's right. That's right. So... Well, last week on the show, I made some comments about the Virgin Mary and Christmas that got the religious right all up in an uproar again. I have to tell you, you guys say you hate me, but you sure do watch the show a lot, and I appreciate it. Anyway, Betty from Hoover, Alabama writes in again. Betty says this, Chris, how dare you insinuate that the story of the Virgin Mary may not be true? The Virgin Mary giving birth to Jesus in the manger is the cornerstone of the Christian religion. Well, Betty, I didn't insinuate that the story wasn't true. What I said was is that the story's complicated. And I'm sorry, anytime you have a woman giving birth to a baby who has not had sex, it's complicated, okay? But since you're calling me out, I'm going to call you out, Betty. The book we're talking about has a story in there about a cat named Noah. Now, he built this ark out of mud, wood, and straw, and he was able to get two of every type of animal on earth inside the ark. The only problem is, this thing would have had to have been the size of an aircraft carrier. Technology to build an aircraft carrier wasn't available until the 20th century. Not to mention that, somebody's got to be on this thing shoveling shit off the side of it 24 hours a day. Am I right about that?
What do the lions eat?
So listen, Betty, I don't care if you do get mad. Hell, I don't even give a damn if you ever watch the show again, so you can ho-ho-ho that in your pipe and smoke it. How's that for a Christmas spirit?
That's right.
Now, Betty, I know you're like a lot of people in this country. You wake up on Sunday morning and you start your day by tuning in to good old John Hagee. Now, for those of you that don't know who John Hagee is, he's the minister of the San Antonio Cornerstone Church. And you want to know who he is? He's the king of the idiots. That's who he is. On his last sermon, he was telling the people in his congregation they need to boycott the stores that say Happy Holidays and only shop at the stores that say Merry Christmas, which I can understand. Because, look, man, we can't have the Muslims, the Hindus, the atheists, the Jews, the agnostics having a good time during the holiday season. By God, Christmas is for the Christians and the Christians only. And we all need to bend over backwards to make sure these people have a good time. I mean, after all, this country was founded by good Christian people. They believed in the Virgin Mary. They believed in God. They believed in Jesus Christ and slavery. That's right. You can't ever give me the reason for that one, can you? All right. Now, Mr. Hagee has also been known to say things like all gay people are going to go to hell, like he's been there and seen it himself. He also has a sermon on YouTube called, Is Barack Obama the Antichrist? I mean, really, do you have to say anything else? You know, Mr. Hagee, I think that if I'm going to apologize to you for calling you king of the idiots. The real idiots are the people that come to your church every Sunday and put money in the offering plate. Over the years, they've made you a very rich man. You have a net worth now of $5 million. But I got to tell you, I think if Jesus came to your church, he wouldn't be very impressed that you are worth $5 million. In fact, the kind of people Jesus hung out with, you guys wouldn't even let through the door on Sunday morning. Yeah, yeah, I know, you're out to save sinners. But let's face it, you want the kind of sinners that dress nice, smell good, and can put money on the offering plate. So from everybody here at the Chris Massey Show, we've got a big message for everybody at the Cornerstone Church in San Antonio, Texas, and especially you, Pastor Hagee. Happy Holiday!
It's a Friday night in Tuckerville, little town that I grew up in. I pull into the parking lot to a place a thousand times I've been. And the stage that I play on, well, you can see it's kind of small. Each face out in the crowd, when don't you know, I know them all. Shine on me, aren't as bright as I hope they'd be. By now I thought I'd be somewhere I may never be. And I know it's hard to think that somehow I can still believe. And the dream that I've been dreaming, it comes true with every song I sing. I've had
songs I write are good. We'll take you to Nashville, get you signed up. Yeah, they said they would. So I listen with a hopeful heart and keep strumming on this old guitar. Another year and I'm still here. All the talk I've heard ain't got me very far. Lights shine on me, aren't as bright as I hope they'd be. By now I thought I'd be somewhere I may never be. And I know it's hard to think that somehow I can still believe. The dream that I've been dreaming, it comes true with every song I sing. Place I can't call mine. And someone's got to be here to play this bar on Friday night. And if destiny has chosen me to be the one, with that I'm alright. It'd be. By now I thought I'd be somewhere I may never be. And I know it's hard to think that somehow I can still believe. The dream that I've been dreaming, it comes true with every song I sing. Every song I sing. Every song I sing.
Got through listening to Chris Massey's new CD, Tuckerville. You guys should go check it out. Great record, great CD, should I say, or record, whichever one you want to talk about or say these days. But I still call them records. Anyway, check it out. Great one. God bless. See you soon. Rock and roll.
Lights shine on me, aren't as bright as I hope it be. By now, thought I'd be somewhere. And I know it's hard to think that somehow I can still believe. The dream that I've been dreaming, it comes true with every song I sing. Every song I sing. Every song